Penguin Random House Canada presents Chaotic Good by Sabrina Benaim. Read for you by the author. Ars Poetica. I can't tell you the secret, only show you the trick again. Can I borrow a pen? Is it blue? Never mind. I've got this rock. Once a man told me to always carry a decent rock. If you don't want to hurt no one, a rock lets people know it's time to leave. If I threw a rock at you, where would you go? I threw a rock at yesterday, it landed in a memory. The girl at the music festival who walked right up to me, cupped my face in her hands and exclaimed, "You look exactly like Anne Hathaway." But fuck Anne Hathaway, that fake bitch. Ha. You're no fake bitch, I can tell. And I don't know how she knew, but she was right. I don't even fake orgasms. I don't have the patience. When I was little, if I went to church, on the way in the car, I'd get one hard candy. I would spend the entire hour of mass sucking slow to practice patience. I am most patient with a blue pen in my hand. Most honest. Most present. And presence is magic. And magic is the language I speak when no one is listening. I secretly hope you are listening. Without you, I am a secret. I wake up every morning to the sound of my alarm at 7:30 a.m. Then I snooze it until 7:45 a.m. Scroll Twitter for the news for 15 minutes. At 8 a.m., I feed my dog, Mabel. While she eats, I brush my teeth. I wash my face. A skincare routine is something I subscribe to. On the dark days, routine is a lighthouse. Clean, prep, bomb, lather into oil, rinse, cleanse, green tea or soy or blueberry, some kind of antioxidant, toner, AHA, BHA, PHA, soak, swipe, pat, serum, hyaluronic, salicylic, lactic acid, ceramides, peptides, niacinamide, retinol, vitamin C, absorb, smooth, plump, refine, reduce, fade, erase, restore a youthful glow, collagen, squalene, rosehip, rehydrate, moisturize, quench, glaze. Routine is keeping me functioning. I am under a spell standing in front of the bathroom mirror, hyperfixating on the perfect shade to make me feel a little more alive, a little better about being myself, a little more palpable. When I look in the mirror, I see a woman I ache to become. On the dark days, insecurity overthrows me. If I don't have makeup on, I don't leave the house. Primer, protective filter, smooth grip, creamy concealer, dot spot cover, discoloration, under eye, a creaseless mask, foundation, second skin, buildable, light, medium, full coverage, dewy finish, setting powder, sheer, translucent, featherweight blur, vanished pores, contour, shape, snatch, elevate, blush, powder, cream, liquid pigment, rosy pinch, warm peach, cool pink, bronzer, where the sun hits, sun-kissed, glow, luminous, highlight, champagne, super sheen, eyes brighten, enhance, accentuate, crease, transition, outer corner, darken, inner corner, lighten, pop, define, waterline, wingtip, felt tip, brush tip, sharpened pencil, lashes, mascara, lengthen, strengthen, volumize, lift, curl, overcurl, slick extreme, lips outline, overline, fill in matte, semi-matte, satin shine, gloss, ultra gleam, mist to last 8, 16, 24 hours, one day at a time. By 8:15, I am throwing on sweatpants, sweat shorts if it's summer, and heading 16 flights down to find Mabel's perfect spot. Back inside, I choose a record to set the tone. By 9:15, I am sitting at my desk, and that's when it starts. Okay, so it starts. How does it start? I guess the poem floats above me. I reach for it. I pinch, I pluck, I grab, but it shoos my hands away. I've frightened it. It shoots back into its house, does not turn on the lights, keeps down the blinds. I send it a letter in the mail. In the letter, I ask the poem what it wants. I ask if it would like to come over to my house. I draw little boxes for yes and no. When I sign my name, I dot the I with a doodled heart. I subscribe the poem to our local newspaper. I take out an ad in the local newspaper inviting the poem to coffee. The poem does not check its mail, does not check its voicemail or email. The poem is trying to ghost me. I make the poem a playlist. Title it something provocative like Come True, Come Through, and then I post a link to the playlist on my Instagram story. The poem does not watch my Instagram story because the poem does not have social media. I go analog. I knock on its door, but it does not answer. I leave little treats on the doorstep, ripe mangoes or Rice Krispie squares, fresh cut flowers, bundles of mint, once a round of Parmesan cheese. Stubborn, the poem stays away. I hear of visits the poem pays to my friends. They send me their drafts, and I say, very good. But the poem does not call me. My door remains unknocked. I try to manifest the poem. I rearrange the crystals. I set fire to a small gathering of rosemary. Pray I dream the poem. I ask the tarot cards what to do. They show me one large cup. I wonder if the poem is thirsty. I rush over to the sink, turn on the faucet, and goblet my hands to catch the water. Here, poem, I call. Bring yourself to this small lake I have made for you. But droplets seep through the cracks in my fingers, and soon my glistening palms are nothing but beggars, and the poem refuses to spare a dime. Forget that poem. Let's talk about a different poem. Let's start at the beginning. I found out about the tumor on a Tuesday. It was Tuesday, March 20th, 2012, and I had a tumor right smack in the middle of my throat. My mother cried in the elevator, in the parking lot, in the Tim Hortons drive-thru, on the phone with my grandmother, who'd had the same diagnosis some 30 years earlier by the same doctor, if you can believe it. And I remember like it was yesterday, Nanny saying through the phone, "Nothing is wrong that can't be fixed." And she was right. The plan was quite simple. They were going to open me up and cut it out. Before I knew the tumor was a tumor, it was a party trick. "Hey, wrap your palm around my neck and feel this thing move when I swallow." Now that it's a tumor, no one knows what to say. Emma said, "Fuck off," when I told her Dr. Solomon came in wearing a headlamp and called it benign, but growing rapidly for apparently no reason at all. How it was basically the size of a squash ball, a fact Shane could not get over. But it was Cameron who said, "Well, yeah. I mean, you swallow everything you want to say. You grew that tumor. You did that." And of course, I did do that. Swallow my feelings for years. If I had a crush, I would write a poem about it. If I had a fight with my father, I would write a poem about it. I'm depressed, write a poem about it. Read the poems to no one. Post them anonymously in online forums. Had I stifled my voice so much that my body had manifested a literal blockage in my throat? Motivated by Cameron and the fear that I have done this to myself, I sign up for a 6-week spoken word workshop. I'm so nervous, I don't sign up until the day it begins. A sidebar, a thing I believe is that some experiences are keys that open doors to new opportunities. The workshop was a key that opened the door to an open mic. The open mic was a key that opened the door to a poetry slam. The first poem I perform is a poem about my tumor 1 week before it is removed. Fast forward 2 years. It is August 2014, and I am on the Toronto Poetry Slam team. We are in Oakland, California for the National Poetry Slam. To our delight and surprise, our team makes it to the semifinals. The night of the competition, many factors are at play. I'm slated to perform a poem I only just shared with my teammates hours earlier, a piece titled "Explaining My Depression to My Mother, A Conversation." When it is my turn to go up, the host mispronounces my name. I'm a little rattled. I'm standing at the mic, staring out into the audience, which is filled with poets I have seen on YouTube. I am starstruck. Then I am speaking. sharing feelings I haven't even told my.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.